One, we are live. Morning, Masele.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Very well, thank you. How's it in the UK?
It's beautiful today. We have a very hot weather, so it's great. We've been having some cold weather, but when we get a bit of heat, you know, for us, we're rejoicing.
Great, great, great. It's hot here too, and we're gradually getting through the winter. Our spring starts really 1st of September, so I think we have about a month to get through. Well, it's good to see you. Good to have you here. Tony?
Yes.
You started recording, right?
You are recording.
Okay. Do we give a few minutes or maybe just another 3 minutes for people to join?
Cool.
So that you don't have to repeat yourself too much.
Cool. Maybe I'm just thinking, I think an important component of any coaching offering is for people to understand the value of coaching and the different value the different coaches can bring, that it's not just a motor car. You know, like you were saying, life coaches for executives. We maybe need to create some content of saying, right, if you're going to be doing this, this is what you need to look for. If you're going to be doing this, this is what you need to look for. Otherwise, when those guys do the tender, how do they assess value? That for me is how do you assess value with a coach?
It depends on who's doing where the tender is coming from. If it is this public tenders, the merit for coaching, sadly, is not the priority. The priority is those calls that, you know, your tax, your BEE, and all of those things. Now, you see a lot of people are going to have high scores there, right? But when now you see their CVs, like this one for National Treasury, they required minimum five years. But I put myself, you know, I put this one, and we're talking about 20 years, we're talking about 30 years and so on. What's the score that they're giving for that? Not much, but it's public. All right. We need to find a way to educate them a little more, because
that's what I'm saying. We need to, as part of our process, help people. This is how you assess value from coaches. Morning, Gerald.
Good morning, Tony. Good morning, Doc.
Good morning, Gerald. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Thank you.
We'll be starting in a minute. You should be conscious of time and respecting people's time. So in a minute, we'll start. And people will join us as they come. So welcome.
Whilst we're waiting, I'd love to get some thoughts from Marcelle and Gerald and Juby, that I can then reorient some of the content towards their core challenges that they have right now. Would you guys share, relating to workplace performance, people, teams, leadership, what your biggest challenge is?
Well, I think from my end, I think the issue is just to try and keep the teams motivated given the different times that we're operating in. And I think it just calls us as leaders to be more on the ground. So I'm happy just to get more insights on that. And I'm also here to learn as well.
I want to make sure that I can focus some of the content towards your core challenge. That's why I'm asking you guys just to share your main area of constraint right now. Thank you. And Jupi and Marcele, what is your core challenge with people right now?
Okay, sorry, I'm out and I'm running, so it can be a bit windy with my network. So what I think for me is collaborating, engaging them, and constantly sort of like, as what Jara just said, like with the times that we are working, we can't see them face to face. So how do we engage them, collaborate them, especially with the vision, so that they can still sort of be motivated to do what they're supposed to do? So it's almost the same line, the challenges that I'm facing now. Like you can sort of like discern the morale is actually going really down and things like that.
Yes. Cool. Thank you. Thanks very much. Jubi?
Hi, Tony. Issues relating to enabling people to perform, mental health issues, resilience. You know, there's so much that is going on around people, and people are demotivated and they just cannot perform. And the fact that you cannot have them in the office physically monitoring them, we don't know exactly what's happening out there. So we need to have a way of managing that.
Cool. Thank you. Morning, Natsiki.
Good morning. Good morning, Tony. Thanks for the opportunity to greet this morning. How are you doing?
Yeah, we're all good. We're about to start. Doc has just turned off his screen. I was asking the participants to give me, what is your primary constraint, your people performance constraint, so I can focus some of the content. What is your biggest constraint with people today?
It is how to focus on the change. Change is... I'll put it in my latest module. It's not really about change anymore. It's about managing uncertainties. And how do you even manage the performance of integrity? Like the last speaker just said, people are behind scenes. You don't even see me now, but I speak. You don't know if I'm really sitting in a position where I'm working, or I am really going to deliver within the certain amount of time I'm given because of the uncertainty. So it is the uncertainty management.
Cool. Thank you. Okay, so I'll keep that in my mind as I go through the content for you guys today. And then you can make notes of any questions for the end. Yes, Doc, let's go.
So, thank you very much. We're not going to waste any more time, so we welcome Tony, co-founder ICMI, speaking to us on Manager2Coach program. This is a major program of ICMI, and we believe that is something that is quite relevant now. We've all spoken about the sign of the times. So how does a manager, beyond just being transactional, can lead people, motivate them, inspire them in these difficult times, challenging times, and like Siki said, managing uncertainty. So I believe we're going to look at some of that today. So thank you, Tony, for here. Thank you, everybody. So, Tony.
Cool. Thanks, Doc. Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for taking the time to be with us. And as usual for our masterclass, hopefully we can give you some value that you can use and apply as you leave us today. Can you all see the screen okay? And can you all hear me okay?
Yeah.
Cool.
Yes, perfectly. Okay. Thank you.
Perfect.
Perfect.
So, please grab a little piece of paper or a pen and make a note on a scale of 0 to 100. How much of your personal potential do you believe you're using right now? In fact, type it in the chat. I'd love to see it in the chat. On a scale of 0 to 100, 0, you're not using your potential at all. 100, you're using the maximum possible potential God has given you. What score out of 100% would you say you're using of your own personal potential? Just type in the chat there, please, for me. You won't have to talk about it or support it or validate it. I'm just curious to see what your self-image, self-reference point is. All right. So here's what I've discovered. I believe that if you say anything over 40-50%, you're sadly misguided. Because imagine if you can only, from an earning point of view, only grow your income by another 25% for the rest of your life. And I see lots of people are saying 75%. I think how you perceive yourself constrains how hard you believe you can push. You know, I'm quite a big guy. I'm 110 kilos. So I've got a little gym upstairs and I can pick up sort of 30, 40, 50 kilos at a time. Most of the ladies on here, it's unlikely that you'll be able to pick up that above your head. But there are times when a mother's child has been in danger and they've picked up the back of a car. So she might have thought she's using her fullest potential, but when the conditions and the constraints were removed, she unleashed more of her potential. And so what I'd like to say for you guys, and I'd love to challenge you guys, my belief as your coach today, I don't think you're using more than 10% of your potential. And what does that do when we start to change your reference point of how much value and power and possibility you think you have? So let's go and let's have a look and see. Technology is changing at an incredible speed, and I'm a techie. I love all the techie stuff. The problem is organizations and groups and teams change slowly, like Natsiki said, was handling this change and this uncertainty. So who's going to help the people stretch between the slow organizational, like walking through mud process, and the speed of light change in quantum computing that is coming at us at a rate that we just don't understand? Somebody has to fill that role. It's not the leader. They don't have time. The manager's role and function isn't that. They try and do that, but they don't typically have the knowledge, skill, ability, training to be able to help people bridge that gap. So have a look at the screen here. These are all professional people in some way or form. What is the common thread between all of these people, every one of them? What is the main thing that binds them all together? If you were to look at this group of people, what is the one, number one, absolute commonality that they all have beyond being a human and having a heart and feeling? The number one thing that they have is, A, they're professional, high performance, pushing as hard as possible. But every one of them is smart enough to have a coach, if not two or three coaches. Do you have a coach? See, because like you said today, you're using 75% of your potential. If you have a coach that's powerful enough and can see enough and understand, there's a lot more available to you. They took a weightlifter and they got him to push as much as he could in specific weights. Then they got a coach to encourage him. His ability to lift weights increased by 28% just by having somebody encouraging and supporting him, not shouting and belittling and berating him, encouraging and uplifting and supporting him. And that's the power that we need today for coaches. So in the chat, please type for me, what's the real benefit of having a coach in your opinion, from your perspective? What is the number one value and benefit of having a really great coach? I'd love to see what kind of comment you think, but what do you believe personally of why it's important and the benefit to have this coach? I'll give you 30 seconds to type. Just has to be a word or two. Just doesn't have to be a whole long sentence. Just a word or two. I'm looking to reframe how you think, how you focus, how you feel, and how you show up today. Blind spots are an important part of the process. We all, if you understand Jahari's window, we all have blind spots. And that's one of the processes, but very often we're scared of having our blind spots pointed out to us. But the real value is for somebody to care enough and believe enough. Roger Bannister wasn't the first man to run the four-minute mile. His coach was here. His coach believed it possible first, and then he got Roger to achieve it. And so for me, the question is, why doesn't everybody have a coach? Why is it important to have at least one or two coaches? But you see, I see a bigger picture, and this is the value that I bring sometimes. Is what people don't understand is as technology is coming at a level that we don't understand. And so we can no longer sit on our laurels and hope and kind of float along using some of our potential. And you as a manager or a leader or as a boss or as an entrepreneur, you can't have a resource that's only giving you a 5% return. It's like buying a racing car that can do 200 miles an hour and you're only doing 20 or 40. I want you to have a look at the possibility of what technology has. Oh, let me go back here. Can you imagine if that's the technology we've had a year or two ago, and that's not, the real power has not been released to the public yet. And Elon Musk says, we do not understand the power that this magnificent, magic, mega intelligence brings. There are already machines that can do most of what we can do. That's one half of the process, is because humans are going to be competing with technology for those roles, functions, and positions. The other critical component, and this is part of my journey with Professor Stoltz, who designed adversity intelligence, is in Africa. In fact, around the world, we have learned helplessness. Learned helplessness is where people have been taught that you can't perform, that no matter what you do, you'll never be good enough. Low self-worth, low self-esteem, low self-confidence are invisible things, unless as a coach you can see through those and start to bring that out in people. And so people have this huge performance. They think they're using 100% or 80% or 70% of their performance, like that elephant. But I promise you, there's a huge lot more of power and potential waiting to be unleashed. So learned helplessness for me is the fundamental thing that we need to, as coaches, be able to reverse and unleash in the people around us. So why do we need coaches? Why coaching as a model? Why not just do training of people? Well, we know that Xerox and from other research, less than 10% of training is applied back in the workplace. And within 30 days, we forget 90% of it. Most people leave an organization because of relationship issues with their immediate superior. And so this relationship foundation is a vital component. And that's what Natsiki was saying and Gerald was saying. And the power of building an incredible connection and bond with somebody, but coming from care to unleash that potential. The challenge and the reality in work today is we have people that are starting out, they're basics, they're novices, and we have experts. The goal is to fast track people up through those layers. But whether you're a novice or an expert, coaching will help you see those blind spots. Coaching becomes an anchor point in how you then are able to reassess and reflect and then start to unleash more of that potential. And for me, the core is self-confidence and self-awareness are the fundamental qualities that enable you to reassess and assess and adjust and then start to bring out more of that power. The real function and the benefit in the longer term is that coaching cultures, companies where coaching is embedded, succeed in every dimension, whether it's service, profitability, happiness, well-being, change management. Coaching is that foundation that guides, that focuses, that energizes, enables people, because coaching isn't about whipping somebody to go faster. It's about standing back and collaborating with them to bring more of their potential together. And that's what we're about at ICMI, and that's what coaching brings. The goal is to unleash that potential for the individual, for the team, of the leader, of the organization. And that's why when I see you say you're using 75%, I want you to become an apprentice of Doc and I, because we can 10x that potential that I think you believe you have. COVID's been a challenge. People have been struggling with these remote situations. most managers have not been trained to be in the management role function position. They were high performers that were put in there because the business needed them. This time, people are waking up and saying, I need more training. I need more knowledge. I need more skill. And the new millennial, kids, looking at my age, the younger generation want growth and development as one of their main functions and reasons why they stay in an organization. So everybody's spending money. Companies are spending money. Leaders are investing and looking at what are the things that we can do. Where do we improve? How do we improve? What do we improve? You know, organizational development and improvement of performance and organizational effectiveness. Millions and billions are spent on it. But have a look at this graph. If you have a look at how much is spent on training, you'll notice that training is one of the lowest returns on investment. And we know that mega billions are invested. And average research on averages show that training brings a 1.1 times return on investment, whereas coaching brings a 4x return. But look at coaching as the functional glue between people, because you come from love, you come from care, you have a different belief, value, and behavior system. And so you will get those quality relationships because now you are beyond just, I'm your manager, perform. And so by adding coaching, you will get all of these other returns on investment. You will raise the standards. You will improve satisfaction and morale. You will empower people to make smarter decisions. You will build the commitment and respect. You are showing respect as a coach. And for me, the longer term orientation of the situation is such an important component that is part of why coaching is the catalyst for succeeding in a business. This graph, the green part is what I see coaching bringing. Because whose job is it to unleash performance? It's not the leader's role. He's not there or she's not there every day in front of the person, tweaking, tuning, and adjusting. The manager's got a different role, function, and position, which is a full-time function. But getting work done through people, following the protocols, processes, policies, procedures, getting work actually out the door, generating the value so that the business creates a profit. As a coach, your goal is to take the systems, the people, the relationships, the individual, the teams, and tweak and adjust and improve and upgrade so that you increase that potential. If you take this graph over a 2 or 3 year period, just in a sales environment, you can double the output on a salesperson because they perform higher, they stay longer. And if you have any idea of what it costs to replace staff today, talent retention is a vital component. Companies are fighting, they are stealing talent. And talent has many, many options available to them. So let's just look at what are the needs. In an organization, there's always a leader, like Doc. He's the front edge of the wedge, the starter of the system. They've got specific skills and expertise, and they're about, why are we doing this? What is our big vision? They create the context and the container for this possibility. And so once they've started the business, they now need managers who plan, organize, control, who do the operational stuff. And both of these functions are full-time positions. But there's no optimization process in this system. And that's why coaching is such a valuable component, because coaching is the amplifier. It's that 10x, the 5x that takes what you have and multiplies that value. And so the leader and manager talk about performance and results. The leader, the driver says, show me the numbers, get me the sales, build the profits. The manager and the coach is where you start to build the winning system. How do we take what we've got? How do we optimize? How do we align? How do we inspire? How do we motivate them? And the leadership and the coaches, the coach in fact enables and empowers the leader to run and go faster. Because when leaders are doing strategy, they need to know, I have capacity to perform. And the coach is the one that unleashes that capacity. And at the intersection of all three is where you get a great manager that gets people to unleash their potential, to stay longer, to love what they do, to love where they're doing it with. And that then becomes the sweet spot of success. And so at ICMI, we've taken our knowledge and skill and ability, and I put some of my stuff. I've been part of the International Society for Performance Improvement. We worked with Professor Stoltz, where I'm trying to think who was talking about resilience. Professor Stoltz designed resilience, and I worked with him through ISPE. I've created the Revolutionary Workplace, which is that framework for high performance and the ClearX framework that we use for coaching and leadership and happiness at work. And so we've taken Doc's knowledge, my knowledge, best practices in the world, and we have packaged a three-day face-to-face or 20 hours online where we have our process, an immersive process that takes you from being that manager-focused person to the more operational, and it takes you to become a high-performance manager and bridges that gap to the heart set. Because for me, there's the head, the left brain head stuff of business and operational, and then there's the right brain, the more heart set, the more conscious part of managing and coaching. Because coaching is not a full-time position with your people. There are times that you have to be a manager and operational in your focus, but coaching, there are opportunities and possibilities and time frames that you set up to do that coaching process. A rugby team's coach doesn't coach them while they're in the game the whole time. He coaches them ahead, lets them play, come back out, right, let's optimize, let's tweak, let's tune, go back in. Whether it's a runner, a boxer, a speaker, coaching is that intervention that just incrementally finds the spot and says, right, let's now, next level, next level, next level. And so we've structured this process to fast track and realign that you have resources, tools, and perspectives that'll take your power of performance and optimization and inspiration and amplify that by 10x. So what is the manager's role that we put together with our coach, a manager to coach process? Because yes, your management position is about results. You are accountable upwards in your organization to get the results delivered based on targets, budgets, and goals. To get those results, we need behavior. And so very often people will send people on workshops for training, but that still doesn't deliver all of the behavior, because the real power starts at number one is creating awareness for yourself and for your people that you're coaching. Awareness gives you choices. From those awareness and choices, we start to look at what beliefs do you have? Many people don't have. Think about for yourself. What is your top three values and beliefs that drive your decision making? What do you believe about people? What do you believe about work? You know, for me, I believe work is a place where people should grow and profit is a byproduct. There are other people whose beliefs is work is a place where you just make money. So as a manager to coach, we start to inculcate a balance of beliefs around people and performance and profits, which then brings us to building a mindset, what we call a growth-optimized mindset. These are invisible things that it's not easy to see on the outside, but we know there are fixed mindsets that are fear-based, and there are growth-optimized or growth-oriented mindsets from Carol Dweck's work that create that belief in the possibility, because you have to have the belief in possibility, like the runner, that coach believed it was possible. And then values. What are the values that you bring to the game? That you value the human above profit. I've seen many, many leaders who are what I call greeders, where their value is push for the profit, and whether we burn people out or you know, we get people to break down tough, that's part of the machine. I really believe that coaching is that balance within the business to bring that heart of, listen, we are people, we are planet, and we are profit. And then that then controls the focus of where we need to focus. There are a million things that you can do, but what are the specifics that you can focus on that will bring the results for you? So what we do is we take you through a process in our manager to coach process, and there are core fundamentals that we start to bring into your awareness and into your skill set. Many people think they listen well, but you'll discover maybe you don't listen as well as you could be. And so having active listening, having asking the right questions. You could ask a question, why am I so stupid or why am I so useless? But if you ask the question of, how do I unleash more of this skill today? Or how do I get more of this passion? Or how do I create more stability? How do I get these people to collaborate better? The questions is where the healing and the growth and the development happen. Because those questions are then going to guide the next actions and the action steps that you are going to take and your people are going to take. Progress is all about action, and business and people's performance and success all is reliant on progress. But it's not progress for progress's sake. In the world we're living today, meaning has to be an important part of that. And as a we did a team building for Standard Bank compliance. And at the very end of the workshop, we were doing a process. And one of the ladies suddenly said, this is why I love what I do. But it took 2 days of us processing with them for her to eventually get to the meaning to say, this is the heart of the meaning for me. And we know that well-being is now part of the consciousness. It's the word in every organizational HR department of how do we make sure we're avoiding the burnout, engaging, building resilience, giving stability, and building that well-being. And so there are a range of activities that are part of that process. And then giving recognition in all of our research from our revolutionary workplace stuff, recognition, appreciation, and validation is down. It's down at like 2 or 3 out of 10. Very few companies have I seen. And that's part of the coaching is giving that recognition. I promise you, if we might have time, I'll tell you a story about my hockey days and the power of somebody paying attention to me and what that did for me. And so part of the coaching coach to a manager to coach process is we share tools. If you're going to create a high performance context, you need to know where you are. You need to know inside the machine. I can look at this beautiful car and say, wow, it looks good. It should be okay. But if you have the diagnostics that show you inside the x-ray inside, this wheel's out of balance. This engine's not firing properly. The fuel's not right. No, we've got something that needs adjustment, and that's what the diagnostics that we bring and that you need. You can't just come along and coach cold. And then there are models and frameworks that we share with you that give you a simple step-by-step process, because for me, and I know with Doc, part of our vision is that everybody becomes a coach and a peer coach. And so you don't want it to take 10 years to qualify academically. You want to have simple tools that you can apply. You can apply for your people, and they can apply for themselves as well. And then team coaching, because yes, individuality is wonderful, but it's the team that matters. It's the collaboration. It's the connection. It's the communication. It's the direction. It's everybody going in the same direction. A team of experts that hate each other and are going in different directions will never succeed to the level we're looking for. And so this is one of the models that we use in the coaching process. It's a simple model and easy to remember. It's grow. Do you want to grow? How do you want to grow? The goal. What is the goal that we're looking to achieve? What are the objectives of this session? And so you'll be able to have this recording if you want this framework. We can send it to you. And then the next part is the reality. So where are we now? A large part of the value of coaching is getting people to understand their real context, conditions, and constraints. Because very often, we're coming from a negative internal voice, and that external coach is that anchor and the stabilizer to say, hold on a second, this is the reality. Here's the power, here's the opportunity. And then what are our options? And the power of coaching that we share is, yes, we are the International Coaching and Mentoring Institute, but coaching is about questions, teaching people how to think, teaching people how to structure their thinking that they themselves become a self-sufficient, you know, spark to flame, flame to fire, fire to furnace. Because if everybody becomes their own coach, it is such a powerful process. And so what are the options? What are the choices we can make? What is the accountability we set up? And then getting that commitment to action and ensuring that the goals are structured. Many people still don't know what SMART goals are. Many people just really are wishy-washy and they have hopes, but they don't have structured, timed goals that they have. And so this grow coaching model comes from like appreciative inquiry. It comes from a positive frame. But this is one of the examples of a coaching model. What I really want to get you to understand in our manager to coach process is understanding the human. We are people. We are not machines. And if you're going to bring out the greatest power and potential as a coach, there are six human needs. And management typically doesn't focus. In every workshop I've asked the managers, what are the top six needs of humans? Very few understand these to this level. Globally, we have needs for certainty, stability, understanding how to handle this uncertainty and anxiety. We need variety. We need some kind of newness in what we're doing. We want significance, that recognition, that well done, I loved how you did that. You know, I really am proud of you, of what you did. It's above and beyond a salary. We don't often talk about love in business, but it's about love and connection and that care for the person. And those are the needs of the ego. And then the needs of the soul is this contribution and growth. What am I contributing to? What is the meaning and how am I growing? And our manager to coach is that growth acceleration part. And so your job as this coach, manager, leader is to help them close their gap, because I promise you, everybody needs this support and guidance and growth. And if you're professional, you know that it's valuable. And so this is your power, is to support them, to be that support in that gap. So we've structured our revolutionary workplace process based on research. And so if you're going to be optimizing your organization, the things that you need to be aware of as a coach is that leadership is an important component. How you show up impacts 35 to 60% of organizational performance. Leadership is a vital component. You as a coach and leader impact engagement, organizational engagement, by huge volumes in performance, in engagement, and that turns into profits. The approach that you use, this coach approach, this positive frame, appreciative approach, has huge impacts, once again, in the momentum and the potential unleashing that happens in an organization. We know from Professor Stoltz's work, the right mindsets, which come from feeling good, which come from feeling validated, which come from having a coach to help us do the inner work to succeed on the outer side, then translates into exponential organizations. And so we have this system that we share with you. It's based on global research on how you as a coach can incrementally grow, develop, expand, raise consciousness, raise confidence in your people. So for me, these are the real benefits of growing A, yourself as a coach, and B, your people to be coached by you and to become peer coaches in an organization. And I use the rocket because we are pushing to greater heights. We need to up-level how we think, how we value people, and what we're looking to achieve in the world. And coaching gives us a structured system, a safe, simple system that we can unleash that potential. But there's benefits for you when you come through our system. You grow in awareness. You improve your performance and connection and relationship quality with people. You start to realize that with an honest mirror, oh, hold on a second, my communication hasn't been so good. You start to become conscious of how you do impact some people and other people not as much. You get feedback. You give feedback in a manner that is constructive. But at the end of the day, it's about building well-being in a way that is sustainable for long-term success for the business and optimizes your people performance. Here's the true power, is that we can, with our process, with our wisdom and experience, we can help you to close your gap, to be the best version of you, to unleash and optimize your performance, to enable you to utilize the maximum of your potential. If you're ready, we'd love to chat to you to find ways to support you going from being that manager to being that manager that people love, to being that manager that leaders want, to being that manager that wherever you go, you are seen as that great manager? Because we know Google says 9 out of 10 managers aren't that great. If you're ready to unleash your potential, get a hold of us, come chat to us, and we'll find a way to take your potential and give you the tools, the technologies, and the internal resources to 10x your potential. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tony. do we have any, it's time now for questions, discussions, feedbacks. Anybody, just unmute yourself, please. Who breaks the ice?
Well, let me ask then, Gerald, what did you get from this process today? You were looking about motivation and inspiring. What can you take and use out of this?
I think what was refreshing on my side was, I think, just more insights around the six needs that people have. I think that's very useful. And it's also a great reminder to us as leaders as well.
Cool. Thank you. Juby.
Hi, Tony. Yeah, in the near future, I'm looking at enrolling onto the Manager2Coach program, definitely. My takeaway from this was the realization that with training, only 30% of training is applied back at the workplace. And I think you said about 90% of it is actually forgotten. That is why we need coaching over and above training. That was a very important issue for me. Thanks.
It's actually 10 to 12% is used a lot, utilized back in the workplace, 10 to 12%. And you can increase that up to 75% if you add coaching to the person once they've gone through the training.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Masele.
What I've got from this was first knowing that we think that we utilize a lot of our potential while we don't. And that's what was like a really good thing to really understand, very refreshing. And another thing is, once as a leader, once you've gone through the right processes, which is coaching, you are able to, I'll be able to do, you know, bring the morale up and collaborate, engage them, and making that environment fun for them. But obviously you need guidance on how to do it, like how you can get there. So yeah, that's what I actually got. Thank you.
Cool. Thank you, Natsiki.
Thank you, Tony, for the moment. For me, absolutely, it is the up leveling the thinking every day. Because this one is the everyday thing, even if you know you have the power, but you need to up-level it every day. Sometimes you wake up with uncertainties that are beyond our control. For instance, take death that is happening around us right now. Even if you are fully equipped, it hits your energy. But now your mindset to make sure that you are always above the radar all the time and manage it very well. So it needs really a design thinking. Thanks for that.
Cool, thank you. I think you're so right around this uncertainty. And that's what I see from the point of view of being a coach. A, you bring the focus towards positive and what we can do, which is around resilience as well. Where do I have control? But also being that anchor point that people can come and interact with. Whenever we do our team building, when I had my other partner, I was the gladiator, push you to the edge, and she was team mom. And often the people just needed somebody to go and talk to and say, listen, I'm being uncertain about this. It's a sounding board, but it's a sounding board with a heart. And so often I find these business leaders are accountants and left brain people, and HR are so busy with the admin stuff. Let me tell you the story quickly. It was my birthday. We were driving from Cape Town. I was in the Navy. We were driving from Cape Town to Kimberley for a hockey tournament. And my girlfriend had fired me. We had broken up. And it was my birthday that nobody knew. And I was a passenger in the car. They wouldn't let me drive. And so I was in many dimensions not feeling great. And we were going to play interprovincial hockey. And I was meant to be the star because I'm center forward and I play hockey with my left hand like tennis. But we got up there. And the people that I was competing against knew me because I played for Defence Force and Southern Transvaal and all the different countries. And so I got into a fight with some people because they didn't want me to play. And so I had too much alcohol because I was sad, drowning my sorrows. And just nothing was good for me that day when we arrived there. And in my craziness, some lady called Trudy, the fact I even remember her name, Trudy Rudgard, was a nurse. She came along and she cleaned me up and wiped me down and everything. And the next day she arrived and came to watch me play. I can tell you, I played like my life depended upon it because I had this one wonderful soul who cared enough. I played like there was a demon after me. I was a 5x better player. I dived, I stretched, I never gave up. Purely because one little special soul was showing an interest. And that is the value that I believe that a coach can bring. Just some attention. I'm looking at you. I appreciate you. Well done. It goes way beyond. Money's not a motivator, but I promise you, that little bit of appreciation is a 10x multiplier. Liz.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tony. For me, the biggest takeaway is basically I have been a manager. I have been a high-performing manager leading teams, sales teams, when I worked in the bank. And I always used to meet my targets. In fact, at one point, I met my annual target just in 3 months of joining the institution. But I can tell you one thing for sure, if I had a coach, I think I wouldn't have stopped. I think I would have done much more. And I think my performance, which I thought was good, was obviously not good enough because I didn't have a coach. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So one of the things I want to ask is, are there just a few of us here, we're still going to have, we usually have more numbers in the evening. But of all of us here, how many of us are leading teams currently? Are we all leading a team? It may be your private company, it may be an organization or whatever. I just want us to look at how we could begin to think now like coaches, because the idea of manager to coach program is the manager is saying, this is the way to do it. And one of the emphases of Tony is care. The coach is saying, all right, how do we do it? How can I help you to do it? Is there anybody here leading teams and has experience in balancing either of those two extremes? Anybody? Or was my question not clear?
Ask him specifically. Marcelle, go.
Can you repeat it, Doc, your question?
So what?
Repeat the question, please.
Can you repeat the question, please?
Okay. There are two parts. One, I want to find out if all of us currently are leading teams. All right. And in leading teams, let's look at these two extremes. One is the typical manager who is bad with that.
You disappeared. Just one is a manager. Start again. One is a manager.
Okay, so one extreme is the manager who typically, you know, they always talk about this difference between the manager and the leader and all that stuff. So here's a manager. This is the way we get it done. And it may take coercion, it may take manipulation, it may take intimidation, it may take whatever it is, pushing, kicking to get you to do it. And what we usually say as human beings, when people tell us what to do, we don't like it. Even our kids don't like it. All right? And they respond usually, mommy, why? Daddy, why? You know? And it is that why that the coach really touches on, because invites you now to have an ownership and is asking, how can I help you? How can we? So there's an ownership there, and I'm backing you up to do it. Now, the organization may not necessarily know what is happening, but you as a team leader, you care for your, like Gerald said, one of those 16, that care, that relationship, as you saw in the chat, that's what really moves people. It's the heart that moves people. So I'm saying, do we, any of us have that experience of balancing both? Because that's the real essence of the manager to coach. That you're still a manager, you're still leading teams, but now you are doing it more as a coach.
I think Tony pointed to me. So I think this is from my point of view, Doc. I think the most important thing, as what you said, is to understand how many hats you're wearing. That's my, for me, how many hats am I wearing in that specific place? So if I'm wearing a hat of a manager, at the same time I'm wearing a hat of a coach, it means I need to be able to understand, where do I become a manager and where do I become a coach? And where do I, yeah, so for me, balancing comes in that manner, knowing this time around, this situation, I can't come as a manager, I need to come as a coach, I need to come somewhere to relate to them, showing them that my heart is also with them. I understand the pressure, I understand, you know, things are being pushed to them, but I, at this point, I don't want to go with the pushing, I want to go with the pull system, understanding from them what is bothering them, and then taking it, and then put it back to how I can actually bring it back to them so that they can understand, and being able to buy it and focus and do it. So for me, that's how I do it.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for that.
Yeah, I will also take an attempt, Doc. Yes, just coming back to your two questions, I think the first question was around whether we're leading teams or not. I'm leading teams. And going on to the second part of your question, I think that is also work in progress and something that I've also been learning over the years to then balance the two. I think it was, must be you, Doc, or Tony, that essentially touched on the issues around the heart. I think over the years, in terms of my leadership experiences, I've also learned that when you focus on the heart, the team then goes the extra mile for you. So I'm also learning to balance the two. And I think I also like that approach, because it then works. Because when you care for people, they then go the extra mile for you as the leader.
Thank you very much for that. Is there any other contributions before we round up? Ask Tony for last words. Any other person want to say something? Any questions? We don't have much in the chat. So if there are no other questions or further clarifications, I'd just like to ask Tony. Thank you, Tony. Last words. Oh, Nsiki, do you want to say something?
Yes, Doc. I'm putting on my... Oh, all right. Yes. Sorry about that. Yes, Doc. Here is one of the challenges that I'm going through right now as a coach and also leading teams, global teams of people who own their own companies. And we are in the same organization foundation globally. So these are the people you, as really, you just said it perfectly. You don't tell them what to do. You do it with them. But still, if they don't come on board in the preparation of things to be done, but only show up in events and disappear again, how do you coach people like that?
Okay. Tony, do you want to respond to that?
I was busy writing notes for what I want to say, okay, for my last words, so I wasn't listening fully to the content.
Okay, I'll respond to that. What Nsiki is saying is, she is a member of a global body of people. Now, these people run their own organization and so on, but it's a number of them come together, all right? And there are maybe tasks given. There's, you don't want to tell them what to do, but we all agree this is what we're going to do. We'll do it together. Now, we know people are different. Motivations are different. Our thoughts, our challenges are different, and so on. Our commitment levels are different. Our convictions are different. Our discipline levels are different. So here now, you have somebody in Sweden, somebody in Belgium, and so on. We now come together. We've agreed. This is what we are going to do. People now show up. They failed to do what they were supposed to do. All right? How do you
manage?
Yeah. I believe that's the scenario, right?
Yes, Doc.
And it could be very frustrating for you as a leader because you're doing everything, all right, to get people to have a buy-in. Let's move together and so on. But it just looks like we are not really on the same vehicle. So that's the question she was asking. Now, how do you motivate such people, especially like we have experienced now? You are not even seeing these people most of the time, all right? It's remote, whatever. It's through these virtual communications. Do you want to respond to that? Or
yes,
just,
sir.
Yeah, now I was asking Tony. Tony, you're still writing your last...
And I've got some thoughts on that, what, that I would share.
Okay, please do, and then you can round up.
So for me, the diagnostic process for me is, was there clarity in the request for performance? If there was, is there capacity in their space, context, conditions, constraints? Do they in fact have the competence to actually perform? Because many people are put into the Peter principle where they don't have that competence. And do they have the commitment? Because you can have all the resources, but they don't have that commitment. So as the leader and the coach of those are the four areas that I would clarify to get to understand the diagnostic and then design a solution to address whatever comes out of that. I'm of the opinion that there are two modes of motivation and inspiration. One is a fear-based, pain-based process, which the reality is it's three times stronger than a pleasure-based process. But I believe you've got to use both of those in optimizing performance. So the clarity people need to understand is, here's what I need, 1, 2, 3. And the consequence of non-performance is ABC. And I think that's a large part of the thing, like Doc asked that question earlier. We ask questions and we think everybody understands. I ask questions and I think people understand. But that clarity is such an important component, and that commitment to the process. Because I think once you're at the level of that level of business, it's not only yourself that is the one that is trying to get the results. There's normally structures underneath you that have to get the information or get the goods or do the stuff. So getting, it's like that Formula One racing car. There can be 50 reasons why it's not winning. You need to find the exact reason and address it for each individual person. Because Doc's right, you know, there are different values and different beliefs and different conditions and contexts and cultures. But if you're leading a team, the culture needs to be clear that there are consequences of non-performance and there are benefits of performance, and those together have to be very, very clear. So I would want to go into a diagnostic and find out what the real thing is. And so if it's not clarity, my fault. If it's not capacity, what do they need? If it's competence, coaching, training, whatever is required to get them, or maybe they're not the right person in the right role. And if it's commitment, then it's a very strong conversation and understanding that we may not be together for a long time should you continue in this manner.
Right. So thank you. Are those also your last words?
My last words would be management essentially is around optimizing and growing results. Coaching is around optimizing and growing people.
Thank you very much. So thank you, Juby. Thank you, Pastor Masale. Thank you, Nseki. Thank you, Les. And Gerald, thanks so much for your time. We appreciate. And we'll see you next month if you are not joining us this evening. Thanks, Tony, also for the presentation. Have a great day.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank